We're actually halfway. We're at the halfway point, guys. And we've been focusing on the Love, Lead, Live as the overarching banner for this whole summer series that will go to the end of August. And so we've all kind of got, we're kind of getting it now, the different aspects of the Love, Lead, Live. But the love is just purely love the Lord your God with all your mind, your heart, your soul. Put your hands up. This is the vertical here. Now turn a little bit so you don't conk the person next to you, then love others. And it forms the shape of a cross. Amen? This is the first. If you don't have this, you're not going to have any of the rest. You got to get this piece down, is that you love Jesus so much that you could even break into tears thinking about his sacrifice for you on the cross. You know, revisit it. You know, maybe you've lost your first love, like Jesus said with the church of Ephesus, but you can regain it. You can regain it, and then once you regain that, then you'll love others, and it'll be unconditionally, and you start right here with, you know, with people right here, and then you go outside, and you just start loving people, you start witnessing to people, and you start being who you're supposed to be, and that's where the lead comes in. You can't really go out and become a disciple or make disciples or be witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth. That's the lead. You can't do that if you don't have the compassion for people. You know, let's take Nepal. That's our Nepal team, single person. But she was called to go to Nepal, you know. So wherever God's calling you, just have your love piece in place, and he will take you places. It might be to the Rock Island Ranch. I'm just saying it might be to the homeless camps. It might be anywhere. It can be to the Navajo Nation this early winter. We'll have a date soon on that, right, Ken? And definitely it can be to Guatemala with our mission. My Spanish-speaking brother, Mike Macias, he's actually in Honduras right now, so pray for him on a medical mission. Then he's going to lead another trip down. He might go down and test out the waters in Guatemala this fall, and then we're going to look for a whole team to go down. So I just love what God's doing. He's doing something through us, through ordinary people, and that's the way it's supposed to be. So love, lead, and then guess what's next? Let's take a deep breath. Let out your breath. Live means you are totally set free to be who you're supposed to be in Jesus Christ. You don't have to worry about what the next person's doing. You don't have to worry about, you know, who's smarter, faster, or anything else. It's you. It's you with your individual fingerprints, just like a snowflake is individual. Many of you are snowflakes, actually. I mean, that's a different story. But I'm just saying, God made you to reach somebody or a group of people, and it's just amazing when you've been set free for that, and you don't have all of the baggage that comes with being a Christian and thinking that you're not enough and you just, you know, all the past is dragging behind you. We want to be set free. Set free. Set free. Amen. Hey, we're starting chapter 5 here. And, you know, chapter 1 was a living hope. Just a quick review. It's not a dead hope. We have a living hope. It's resurrection power. Our living hope is that Jesus Christ raised from the dead, and he's coming back for us. Amen. And then chapter 2 is a living stone, and we found out we are what's building the kingdom. We're like stones being laid in the wall of God's spiritual kingdom. And then living legacy. Remember, I tried to really hammer the point that you just don't want to leave a legacy. You know, like, yeah, so-and-so was pretty good, and you go to the memorial. You want to leave a living legacy where you've trained up other people in the church. You've trained up other people in your family. You've trained up people at your workplace, at your school, to carry on when you're gone. And get them up and flying. That's a living legacy. And then we talked about a life for God last week. How do we just live for God? And it was really insightful, I think, is that if you start with, I want to live in his presence. I want to worship in the Spirit, pray in the Spirit. I want to, I want to do everything. I want to saddle up in the Spirit. Oh, FYI, that video wasn't showing the Rock Island Ranch horses either. I don't want anybody to think, okay, that's what we got to do. Yes, it's for the Lord.
Quit whining.
So our chapter one, I've entitled, I love this picture, by the way. It's the elders and the youngers. Now, this is the oldest running feud ever. It sounds like the Hatfields and McCoys, doesn't it? This is the elders and the youngers. I'll explain it all as we read it. Chapter 5, verse 1 says, "And now a word to you who are elders in the church. I too," and Peter's speaking here, "I too am an elder." So he's speaking of not in their church, but talking about a more of a worldview of Christianity. I mean, it's teamwork here, okay? It's the body of Christ, not individual pieces here or parts. "I too am an elder and a witness to the suffering of Christ." So he's saying, you know what? I was there. I was there. I knew him. I camped out with him. I saw him resurrected. I mean, this is a firsthand witness. And he says, "I too will share in his glory when he is revealed to the whole world." You know, when is that going to be? Well, actually, I've tried to tell you, you know, the catching away of the church, the bride, is a separate event than Jesus revealing himself to the whole world and smiting the nations. I don't know. I've had a couple of pieces here on Made Worthy this last week just on that. And he will come down, and it will be the revelation of Jesus Christ, hence the name of the last book of the Bible, is being revealed to the world. It's like, oh, wow, that Jesus does have authority over all things. And guess who's going to be revealed with him? His bride. So this is awesome stuff here. And the only reason I mention that's because I can and I like it. I mean, that is our hope. It's our hope that he's coming back for us, and we're going to ride on white horses, and they won't be bucking or kicking or biting or anything. Then it says, "As a fellow elder, I appeal to you, care for the flock that God has entrusted to you." Now, this is a really subject that I'm adamant about. I know that I've been called to be a little s shepherd. Little s. I mean, tiny s. Even leave the s off if you want to, but it sounds stupid. It's like Frank's an eppard. That could cause conflict even there. I mean, what'd you call me? But I'm a little s shepherd, but I will defend my flock. I will defend it. And here it says, care for the flock that's been entrusted to you. Care for the flock. Watch over it willingly, not grudgingly, not for what you will get out of it, but because you are eager to serve God. So those of you, I just want you to know, when we're talking about elders and the descriptions we see in Timothy and whatnot, it's, you know, pastors, elders, overseers, deacons, servant leaders, and it goes on and on, right? And what it's really talking about is, yes, there's a set of elders, but everybody who rises up through leadership, it's just amazing. You know, one of the women here at our church, and I'm not going to mention her name because it would embarrass her, but Veronica had called me, and Veronica's home study, we've got studies going on in homes, which are awesome, you know, and it just is. And her girls, I hate to say it like that, but she says her girls are the ones that are facilitating the chili cook-off October 6th, isn't it? October 6th, it's our birthday party. They say it's your birthday, come on. Yeah, we're going to have soup and chili and everything. But the really cool thing is maybe they haven't ever organized or overseen anything like this ever. And so they start rising up. This is where the elders and the younger debate all comes in, because it's fluid. It's fluid. There's no clergy-laity distinction, okay? There's no, hey, I'm up here and you're down here, and that's just the way it is. This whole thing is fluid. And since our church believes in a format of Acts 2:42, we actually are under-shepherding. So I'm not over-shepherding. I'm not like, okay, everybody listen to me. No, I'm trying to raise up leaders all the time. And you see a few of them like Jacob, but there's a whole bunch of people that you're maybe not aware of that are trying to be lifted up. So when you become an elder in this place, that means you know, hey, drop to the bottom and start lifting people up. Raise up other leaders. Raise up other teachers. Raise up people that can facilitate things like the chili soup cook-off, you know, so that one person isn't doing all of it, and they get to rise up in Holy Spirit power and do something really awesome. So that's what we're talking about. And then it says in verse 3, don't lord over the people assigned to your care. Could you imagine that? I mean, I can, but you can't imagine it here. You know, Tony lording over you, or, you know, you will come up to the front row. I know churches that call and check what you make, and they want their fair share. That's sad. We're 12 years without taking an offering. And it's, you know, but the boxes. Thank you, Danny. Good timing again. Don't lord over the people assigned to your care, but lead them. Say lead them. Lead them is a whole different thing than driving them. You know, we drive cattle. I was raised on a cattle ranch. You drive them, yahoo! Get on, you know, get along, little doggy. And that's not talking about a dachshund either. Oh, I've been waiting for years of that. Didn't work out too good. But when you drive cattle, then if you try to drive horses, guess what you got? It's a mess. You have to lead horses. So you get out in front, you have a lead horse. And that's the same with the church. You can't drive people to greatness. You can't. You have to lead by example, and your eldership or anybody who's in leadership at all, even if it's our greeting team, you know, that's trying to show others how to greet properly. Hey, you're leading by example, buddy. I always wanted to say that too. Buddy, you're leading by example. And that's exactly what Jesus did when he dropped down at the Seder meal and started washing people's feet. You know, Jesus also said that night, he says, I won't have another sip of wine till I'm having it with you, and I'm going to feed you. I'm going to feed you. I'm going to serve you and give you food and wine. Even in his full glory, he wants to be a servant to us. So anybody who's rising up through leadership, take note. Take note. We lead by example. And it says here, I didn't even finish, but lead them by your own good example. And then in verse 4 it says, and when the great shepherd appears, say great shepherd. Yeah, his name is Jesus. And when he appears, you'll receive a crown, never-ending glory and honor. Of course, we know we'll cast those crowns. So the only reason I put this silly picture here is it's just been, through the ages, it's been the battle between the elders and the youngers. So elders doesn't mean that you're old. Just look at me. No, I'm just kidding. Elders doesn't mean you're old physically. It means you're spiritually mature. Is everybody with me? So you can be one of the youngers and actually be older. This doesn't make any sense. You can be an older younger because you're not spiritually mature. So this whole thing is fluid. And that's what I love about our youth and what's happening and raising up leaders. And it's not like they're going to take the baton. I don't even like the term. I don't even like the thought of passing the baton, because I'm not giving up till the Lord takes me. But it is about raising up leaders. And they might be youngers that are becoming elders, but there's a lot of elders here that are still youngers. Are you with me? That doesn't make any sense. Just say it makes sense so I can move on. Okay, it makes sense. So, yeah, maybe. We're not sure. They just like the picture of everybody holding guns. We're going to move on. This is kind of the title track here, Life of Humility. But listen to this. And all of you, and this is still really under the context of leadership, but we're going to break it out to all of us. And all of you serve each other in humility. And then he, of course, grabs Proverbs 11:31 and says, God opposes the proud, but favors the humble. That's really all I need to hear. How about you? I want God to be on my side. I want the favor of God to be poured out upon me. And you're not going to get it if you are proud in any way. Pride is actually what brought the devil down. You know what I'm saying? So we don't want to be prideful. And that's not meaning that you're not sure of yourself. That's a whole different thing. When somebody goes, yeah, you're sure full of yourself. Well, you know, we need to get control on that. But God wants people that are sure of their footing in Him. He wants people to have their identity wrapped in Him, not their situations or their circumstances. So to be, to be steady and to be, steadfast and all of those things, it doesn't mean that you're proud. As a matter of fact, just turn around and say, yeah, I'm proud, all right. I'm proud of Him. I'm proud of the one that paid the price. And you can also be proud of the people you're raising up, spiritually proud of the girls heading up the Chilean soup night. That's going to be so awesome. FYI, and I know I can get sidetracked really quick because I have ADHA or something like that. I can't even spell it. But that night, I want you to get excited about it because we're going to try to do the whole church out here. So bring your lawn chairs just in case we can't fit on the bleachers. But wouldn't that be awesome? It'd be the first time we've had a full service in the outsider church. Not every church has an outsider church. It's just us. So we want, and the youth have been using it. Campfire Discipleship's been using it. And us out there, it's going to be awesome. So then in verse 6, back on track, it says, so humble yourself under the mighty power of God. Huh, yeah, thank you for the amen. It's just like, oh, wow. I want to humble myself under the mighty power of God, and at the right time, He will lift you up in honor. Give all your worries and cares to God, for He cares for you. Think about that last line. We hang on to our worries and cares, don't we? I mean, it's just like trying to pull a cat out of a car, is to get us to give up our worries. We're worrying about everything. What could happen tomorrow? You know, we need to live more in the moment and say, Lord, you know, I am casting all of my burdens on You, all of my worries on You. And it says here, because He cares for you. He cares for you. There's scripture that says He bends down to hear your prayers. He's not distant. He's right here if you want Him to be. And that's our goal with the Love Lead Lit, Love Lead Live. I can't even say it. I might have to have somebody else just say that. But it's true. But here we come to verse 8. Now listen to this. Stay alert. Say stay alert with me. Stay alert. You know, there's nothing like a Christian for falling asleep. We're like Rip Van Winkle. We wake up every once in a while. It says stay alert. Watch out for your great enemy. It doesn't say enemies. Says your great enemy, the devil. He prowls like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Stand firm against him. Anytime you say that, you got to stomp. And be strong in your faith. Well, first off, I love where it says stand firm. We hear that all through scripture. Stand firm. Does that mean you're all wimpy and everything? No, it's the opposite. You are taking a stand. It's just like the dog soldier story where you drive a stake in the ground. Stand firm and be strong in your faith. I know that's tough sometimes, but be strong in your faith. But picture the whole thing about the roaring lion. You know, so many times we get taken out for really just a couple of reasons. I mean, and we know what gets us taken out. One is we decide to not live a victorious life. You know, one is we're just overcome by our situations and circumstances. You know, we're so worried about every little thing. And it could be, I was talking with the worship team today, sometimes we're worried about our kids making poor choices or our grandkids making poor choices. And I read a quote from Ann Graham Lotz this week that said, you know, don't let that define who you are in Christ. Just because, you know, somebody got a crazy, you know, tattoo across their forehead or something, and you're just like, oh my gosh, I can't even show up at church anymore. Do not go there. And she ended her quote by saying, just remember, God has problems with His children too. And that's you guys, okay? So that's one of the things that takes out. We just get so discouraged with everything that's happening to us that we get down, we can't get up. The other thing that takes us out is we get isolated. You know, there's a reason why Scripture says, do not forsake the assembling together. We are supposed to come in here, iron sharpens iron, right? Enter worship, exit to serve. But you've all seen, you know, the nature program. When Brendan and I were in Mexico, the TV in our room, everything was in Spanish, and there were two channels. So we didn't even turn it up, but we had it on because it was the National Geographic Wild. So it was always an elephant run or a giraffe, you know, or fighting, you know, something going on. But one thing I learned from that is when the gazelles are all running one direction, the lion doesn't keep following the herd. I don't know if they call them herds, but the lion doesn't keep following the herd. The lion waits for the one that gets separated. He's looking for the weak one, the one that's worrying, the one that's got situations and circumstances where their identity in Christ is wrapped in instead of Jesus himself. And then once they get isolated and they're going, gosh, I haven't even been to church in a long time. Well, guess what? You better start looking out the front window because there's probably a lion circling. Because he's looking for the one that got separated and he's looking for the weak one. I'm just telling you, this is the truth. It is the truth. So, yeah, here we go. Started getting crazy there. And so I want to read on here. Remember that your Christian brothers and sisters all over the world are going through the same kind of suffering you are. Do you realize that there's a lot of suffering in the world? And it's, I know it's across the board, but you know, when you think about what happened, just pick anywhere in Syria or northern Iraq, you know, Mosul, go back, think of Aleppo. You know, when ISIS came to Aleppo, they started marking the doors. They went in, just a couple of guys, and said, hey, who lives there? Yeah, they're Christians. They marked the door with the mark of the Nazarene. It's kind of a backwards J with a dot on top. And then when the army got there, it's like, okay, they've already been judged. Either that we're going to kill them, or we're going to put them in slavery, or you know, something horrible is going to happen to them. And Christians are still being held. You think, well, ISIS has kind of died down. There's 20,000 Christian slaves in southern Syria right now. And most of them are sex slaves. They're having to bear the children of these animals, which we should be praying for too. But I'm saying the suffering, if you're going, well, I guess there's not a lot of suffering these days. Oh my gosh, get out of your head here in Lone Jack, Lee Summit, wherever you're coming from, and look around the world. It's bad. It's bad. And when the martyrs came to the throne of God in Revelation, and they said, how long, Lord? How long? And God says, just a little bit longer. Just a little bit longer. So keep them lifted up. Any kind of relief you can give them, especially prayer. And remember, they are suffering. Christian brothers and sisters all over the world going through the same kind of suffering you are. Because when this was written, of course, the suffering was coming down in the whole part of Asia Minor. It was coming down everywhere. In his kindness, God called you to share his eternal glory by means of Jesus Christ. So are we to share his eternal glory? Well, that's what it says. We are to share in his eternal glory. You know, we've got everything to live for. You know what I'm saying? And it's a shame that we can't share that with other people. And so we get better and better and better, right? This isn't like, okay, I'm going to scold you. No, we just want to get better. We want to make where it's easier to bring up the gospel or to at least let people know where we stand. And you'd be surprised where that leads, let me tell you. And it says to share in his eternal glory by means of Jesus Christ. So after you have suffered a little while, it always says a little while. It seems like, man, it's been a long time. He will restore, support, and strengthen you. And he will place you on a firm foundation. All power to him forever. And everybody say amen. This is the truth. This is our future if you are in Christ Jesus. The suffering's momentary and light, as James says. It's just going to be a blink of an eye until we see his face. And you know, we're supposed to stand firm in his grace. We are. Verse 12 says, I have written and sent this short letter to you with the help of Silas, who I've commended to you as a faithful brother. Now listen to this. My purpose in writing this is to encourage you. Encourage you. Encourage you and assure you that what you are experiencing is truly a part of God's grace. Wow, who would have ever thunk it? Well, let me tell you, Christian, if you're going, well, you don't know what I'm going through. He does. Or if you're thinking, yeah, I, you know, the pain, no, he knows. Or the sorrow of a family member, you know, in trouble, no, he knows. There's nothing that Jesus Christ hasn't experienced. That's why it came down so badly at the end. They didn't take Jesus in the garden. They did not take Jesus in the garden. He said, I am he. I am. He had to say it several times. And if you remember, they all fell down several times, which was awesome. Just the spoken word of Jesus. But he gave himself up for us. And that whipping post incident, nobody would have survived that. It took the Son of Man and the Son of God to live through what he went through. And to hang on that cross, let me tell you, nobody could have survived that. And he didn't either. But he had resurrection power as a promise from God for himself and for all of us. What a happy ending this is going to be, I'm telling you. And we're just going to go wild when we get to heaven and get to be together. God's grace, stand. Oh, my purpose of writing you, of course, is to encourage you, assure you what you experience is truly a part of God's grace for you. And then this is what, I love this. Stand firm in his grace. You know, the grace of God. Oh, let me tell you. Can we talk about the grace of God? You know, I mean, even the simple definition is to receive something you don't deserve. If anybody here thinks that they deserve eternal life or a brand new body or to be forgiven for being born in default on the wrong side of the tracks, we don't deserve anything. And that's why I love talking to people that kind of have a works-based idea of it all. And they're going, yeah, I just wish, you know, I hope I do enough to outweigh the bad. And there's your, here's your opportunity. Say, you can know. You can know. And we can know. You know, the whole thing of the Christian life is faith and doubt. Strength and weakness. I mean, it just comes hand in hand. Come on. Anybody here that goes, no, I'm strong all the time. Let me tell you, yeah, right. I'm telling you, you're not. You're not. And it might be in the middle of the night. It might be when you're alone. You don't want to show it in front of everybody else. But we are walking in the dark. And faith is the only thing that promises us that we've got a firm footing under our next step, church. So we've got to get our belief pumped up. We've got to get our faith pumped up. And we have to stand firm in his grace, which is massive. His grace is massive. And then let me finish. There's a few more words in the chapter. It says, your sister church in Babylon sends you greetings. And you're wondering, well, what's that about? Babylon was completely destroyed, never built again. Peter's talking about Rome. So that's just what they call it. And it's really bad there at this time. Really bad. And you'll find out in our next chat, in our next book, that Peter's heading towards his end by way of the new Babylon there in Rome. It says, I send you greetings, and so does my son Mark. This is John Mark, the author of the Gospel of Mark. Greet each other with Christian love, or your version might say a holy kiss. So just be careful of that during flu season. A holy hug, maybe. A holy, yeah, be careful of that. But then it ends with, peace be with you all who are in Christ. Amen. As we think about peace be with you, that is exactly what Jesus Christ said when he showed himself to the disciples after his resurrection. He said, peace be with you. Actually, the translation is peace be on you, peace be in you. It's just, it's got a big meaning to it, and it's even bigger than that, because the word that was used is Shalom Elohim in the Hebrew. It's the believer's peace. It's all inclusive. It has all of the fruit of the Spirit. It's got all kinds of stuff. There's another version of Shalom Elohim that was used even in the Old Testament for warriors. Do you ever wonder why men can go into battle? Especially when you look at Joshua's battles and stuff, and they're just like, yeah, for our God. Well, God would put on them, it was a prayer, that they would receive Shalom Elohim, the warrior's peace. Hey, I'm a warrior. I'm running into battle. God's got this, is what it really means. And here he says, peace be with all of you who are in Christ. It's the peace that passes all understanding. It's the peace that is all inclusive for the believer. Other people don't have it. You see the world, they're all upset, they're all uptight, they're just running back and forth. They don't know what to do with themselves. So they've got a God hole inside of them, and they're filling it with everything from drugs to money to material things, houses and cars. You can imagine throwing all that in a God hole and it's still not filling it, because they need the peace of God, the Shalom Elohim, that only comes from being a follower of Christ. Let's just close our eyes. You know, Lord, as we just closed chapter, the first book, all five chapters, and we've learned so much, but wow, the peace that passes all understanding. You want us to have that as believers, as we suffer and serve, and we're waiting for your return or for you to call us home? What an awesome thought, Lord. You know what? As a little S shepherd standing up here, I've got to ask the question. Have you surrendered your life? Totally. You're not holding back. You don't have areas that you just can't surrender because it would be so difficult, or areas you're protecting because there's pleasure there. Is there areas in your life that you haven't surrendered? And have you even surrendered the first time? And if you're here and you're going, I don't know that I know Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. I don't know if I died tonight if I would go to heaven. And you're thinking, have I done enough good to outweigh all the bad? Well, stop it. There's only one way, and it's Jesus. And it's surrendering to Him. And if you want to do that tonight, with all eyes down, if you want to seal the deal tonight, just raise a hand up. Raise a hand up for Jesus. Anybody want to seal the deal for Jesus here tonight? Or if you're watching at home, it's you too. Seal the deal tonight. For the rest of you, man, we've learned a lot, but really it's pretty simple. Love the Lord our God with all of our hearts, our minds, our strength, and love others. And then lead out, because we are supposed to represent Jesus Christ in this world. And then live freely. Live freely. Lord, we thank you and we praise you. We give you all the honor. We give you all the glory. In the name of Jesus Christ, we love you. We praise you. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. And all God's children said, what? Amen. Stand firm in His grace. Anybody? Stand firm in His grace. Be bold. Be courageous. This is light and momentary. And then we're going to see what we were really made for. And it's going to blow your socks off. Matter of fact, just take your socks off now. Hey, Kim, can I just sing through this? It'll make it easier. This